My lords, I extend a warm welcome to the noble lord, Lord Stevens. Although, like my noble friend, Baroness McIntosh, I will respectfully disagree on the topic of water fluoridation, a measure that I strongly oppose and which I will focus on tonight. It is disappointing that mandatory fluoridation has been slipped virtually unnoticed into the nether regions of such an important bill without its own debate and without proper scrutiny. Moreover, it all seems very rushed. I stand before noble lords today not as a scientist, nor as a connected party of a lobby group, but as someone who have grave concerns about the risks posed by widespread water fluoridation. I contend there is high quality evidence that has come to light in North America since 2017 to suggest that fluoride can damage the developing brain and reduce IQ. And I conclude that water fluoridation has not been adequately researched by those who have initiated this bill. The practice cannot be considered safe and should not be extended throughout the country. In Europe, the only countries that have agreed to water fluoridation are Ireland, the UK with 10% population coverage, with Spain, Poland and Serbia to a very minor extent. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention in their studies of 1999 and 2001 has acknowledged that fluoride's benefits are mainly topical, not systemic. There really is no need to swallow fluoride or put it in drinking water when topical treatments like fluoridated toothpaste are available. Children, and particularly bottle-fed babies, unfortunately are being overexposed to fluoride. Infants consuming formula mixed with such water receive the highest exposure to fluoride by body weight and a dosage 100 to 200 times higher than a breastfed baby. This overexposure leads to dental fluorosis, or discoloration of the enamel, when the permanent teeth erupt. Since we have now learnt that fluoride crosses the placental membrane, it is evident that the fetus receives an even higher exposure than a bottle-fed infant at a more vulnerable time. Proponents claim that over 60 years of research has demonstrated that the measure is safe and effective. However, most of that research has focused on the hard tissues, the teeth and bone. It is only recently that high-quality research has focused on other tissues with very disturbing results. According to recent US government-funded studies from Bashash 2017 and 2018, Green 2019 until 2020, published in leading global journals, fluoride has the potential to damage the developing brain of both the fetus and the infant, leading to lowered intelligence and increased symptoms of ADHD. Making these observations even more alarming is that the damage was observed in fluoridated communities in Canada, a country that fluoridates at 0.7 parts per million versus 1 part per million in the UK. The Till paper showed an IQ decline of 9 points amongst bottle-fed children in fluoridated versus non-fluoridated communities. These findings are so serious that they make any discussion of dental benefits of this practice moot. You can repair a damaged tooth, but not a damaged brain. The irony of the bill's proposals is that they will harm most those who they seek to help. Those most likely to suffer from a poor nutrition and thus most likely to be vulnerable to fluoride's toxic side effects are the less well-off, who are the very people being targeted by the proposed fluoridation programs. We should be spending our efforts trying to increase the access to dental care for low-income families and invest in programs like Child Smile in Scotland. In his written evidence to the recent white paper, Professor Stephen Peckham, government advisor to the current Select Committee on Health in the other place, chaired by Jeremy Hunt, stated as follows: if the Secretary of State was looking for ways to improve oral health, then water fluoridation should not be even considered given its lack of effectiveness. More attention should be given to schemes such as Child Smile in Scotland, which has been proven to reduce inequalities, reduce admissions for tooth extractions, and provide broader public health benefits beyond oral health. Such a scheme links very clearly to addressing obesity issues as well. End of quote. Professor Peckham rebuts government claims in the white paper that water fluoridation is proven to improve oral health and reduce oral health inequalities, and argues such claims are based on inconclusive evidence and predominantly studies carried out pre-1975, before the wide use of fluoride toothpaste. Peckham further argues, we should not be considering any new schemes given the increasing amount of evidence linking fluoridation to harmful health effects. Only 8 years ago, the government made the decision to transfer decisions on this issue from the NHS strategic health authorities to local government. The specific reason given was that local communities should have a stronger say. This bill reverses this position and reverts to centralisation of control with the DHSC. My Lords, surely if health measures are to be imposed on the individual and if the community's final say in the matter is removed, the scientific evidence should show overwhelmingly that the measure is both beneficial and safe. In the case of water fluoridation, I do not believe it is either. At the very least, I would urge a delay in proceeding with this measure until the National Toxicology Program in the US, which for the last 5 years has been undertaking a systematic review of the fluoride neurotoxicology studies, publishes its report, expected in early 2022. The public will not easily forgive us for rushing ahead without availing ourselves of the best scientific research on the matter.